on this side. I've always liked taking pictures. I think it's just a matter of capturing something in its natural state. Where I live here, it's a never-ending opportunities walking by every day. I just like the challenge. The part of it is getting close, but I also like to pride myself in not being disruptive to the animal. And one of my favorite turkey pictures is right here in the yard out the window. There are a bunch of toms all strutting together, and the ones that I particularly like. This was kind of a neat one of a turkey release I did with a bunch of kids. You know, most people will say, someday I'm going to, and I decided not to wait around for that. So several years before I retired, I decided to move out to the country. Always kind of liked this spot and made a lot of improvements since I've been here, so it's been a real joy. I've turkey hunted for quite a few years and have been successful. I love the game, and the game is primarily walking. Mostly around here we'll get skunks, maybe a raccoon or two. We don't have really any possums up here. More likely it's either a crow, something that I don't know why we drop it out here on the trail, but coyotes, foxes, everything's going to eat on them. The turkeys will actually re-nest if something finds their nest and starts to prey on it. They'll leave it and they'll re-nest again. But this was obviously an egg that was picked out of a nest. It's fresh and we're nowhere near anything that would be where they would hatch. I don't know what kind of scat that is, but whatever was in here makes me think it was some kind of a bird. Probably one part of my life where it was more about scoring or getting a bird or doing whatever, and for quite a few years now it hasn't been. It's more, can I get in the game and can we play? Kind of, that's the experience for me. In the mountains, or really anywhere in this region, whether it's Idaho, Wyoming, Montana, Oregon, Washington, in the summer, there's plenty of habitat. All of this will be covered with turkeys. There'll be plenty of places to nest, to hide. And then in the winter, when the snow gets deep up here, they'll all head down and they'll spend their time down at the bottom of the valley. And so what we try to do with our habitat projects is move habitat projects down lower so that the turkeys don't spend their time down on the highway and down in residential areas or on farms. Try to move them up the hill a little bit where they have some feed and protection. When I go hunting in Idaho, for me, I can spend as much time following a skunk around for 20 minutes, figuring out what it's doing, what it's eating, where it's going, and, you know, watch deer. And a lot of times I'll see elk or moose or whatever else. And those type of things to me is that's the experience. It's not going out and killing something. It's going out and having the full experience. And if you're successful, great. If you're not, you know, it's not the end of the day.
I find them fascinating. You know, people will say they're dumb birds or they're this or that. I watch them every day, so I see every aspect of their life. So if I come outside and I hear a certain type of putt real fast, I call it a popcorn putt, I know there's a golden eagle somewhere in this canyon, because that's what they do. And they run toward the brush and they make that same noise with a threat from the air. If it's something from the ground, like I had some mountain lions in here last winter for quite a while, and when they would come in, it would be a different kind of putt, and they would all run to the open, and they would watch down where the mountain lion was. And you just see the interaction. They recognize me a little bit. When other people around, they're a little more nervous, or they'll flat out take off if they feel any kind of threat. But interestingly, if I leave my house and I go down below on some other property that I have down lower, I run into the same turkeys. They'll take off like they're being, you know, like they never saw me before.
As biologists learned more about wild turkeys, they discovered a better way to expand their populations. They started using rocket nets to trap as many birds in the wild as they could. And these wild turkeys were then released into new areas that had the right habitat, but no wild turkeys.
I work with Fish and Game on a lot of different projects, and I started to try to figure out a more effective way to trap turkeys. Rocket nets are a lot of fun, and it's really cool, the explosions and all, but it's not real efficient, and it's kind of hard on the birds. So I came up with a trapping system that came out of Texas, I believe, where it's a 8x16 metal panel trap. That we figured out how to get them in and not let them get out. We can catch them, box them, and move them pretty quickly. Trapping keeps the population in, not in check as far as, you know, numbers, but where they're located. And it's not a perfect system by any means, and there's always going to be people that don't want turkeys in their yard, and there's always people that want to leave them all alone and have more turkeys in their yard. I got a contact from Boise, from the Idaho Fish and Game, and they wanted to do a teacher workshop here called Wild About Turkeys. Well, we did it here at my property because we wanted them to experience turkeys flying down out of a tree, being close to them, being in the middle of families going about without being detected. We set up a bunch of blinds, we put a bunch of teachers in them, they had a blast.
The teachers learn about turkey hunting and turkey calls. They are taught crafts, conservation, and activities that reinforce the concepts. And all of these ideas are laid out in a manual for them to take home. For today's busy teachers, it provides tools that they don't have the time to search for themselves.
And as that program developed over a few years, it became very popular. So the National Wild Turkey Federation actually picked up our program, helped us make it into a national program, and now it's the National Wild About Turkeys program for the entire country that was developed right here.
Is that an oak?
Yep,
that's an oak. Pine trees.
So right here today, we're at Joe's nursery. He's a Turkey Federation volunteer, and he's working with us on a cottonwood project. Cottonwoods are one of the preferred roost trees for turkeys in Idaho. If they have cottonwoods, they're gonna roost in them.
The National Wild Turkey Federation, I can see directly what they do. I've always looked at the National Wild Turkey Federation as our organization. It's not a bunch of people back in Edgefield, South Carolina, deciding what everybody's gonna do. I mean, we have biologists that help us locally. We have regional people that help us do things.
So we're in Joe's tree yard. While it might look small, it's deceptively actually quite big. This is where we source almost all of our trees for our Turkey Federation projects. What we do is we take little seedlings from like a standard greenhouse or nursery, and with Joe and volunteers, we pot them and we put them in rows here. And the reason we do this is because we want these trees to be the best suited to survive here in Southeast Idaho. Joe has really maximized, you know, what we're able to do for habitat, and so it's worked out really great for us. You know, it's been great for Joe and our volunteer program, and we're really excited.
I think for everybody, they hesitate about getting involved in a project, so just get involved. I try to look for projects or things that I think are of value. Obviously, you can't just walk away from, you know, trees that you're producing every year, and there's a lot of effort that goes into that, but the reward is well worth it. The idea here is, in this part of the West in Idaho, we have about 10 inches of moisture a year. We've historically planted a lot of trees and we get a very low success rate, so we've needed a watering system for the first couple years. And the system we came up with was this Groasis water box. There's a lot of systems, but this is the one that seems to work around here. We've only been doing it for 3 years, but the success rate is just phenomenal compared to what we've had. So instead of having about 20% of our plants survive long range, we seem to be getting closer to 80% surviving now, maybe losing 20%, which in anybody's book is a screaming success.
There's your yam. A yam, what a yam. Hello. So wild game usually needs an acid and an oil when you cook it. And the acid in this case is red wine and Bragg's amino acids. And the fat or the oil is olive oil. I get whatever I want.
When you do a class and you come in and their expectation is you're going to be this turkey guy talking all about shooting turkeys, and you leave with them not wanting you to go because you've talked about biology, you've talked about habitat, you've talked about anatomy and physiology, you've talked about all the characteristics of birds, and then you fed them a meal, a really good meal made up of the same thing you're talking about. And you can see them all of a sudden make that connection between, you know, the earth and what they do. So that's very rewarding to me.
I had a robin nest.
As you get older, you want to leave at least some mark on what you've had influence on. I had a kid come up here last year and say, "You probably don't remember me." He's a great big guy. And I was like, "No." And he goes, "You turned me into a turkey hunter 10 years ago. And I've always wanted to tell you thank you." And you know, those are the kind of things that really make you keep doing it.